الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase all of you with beneficent knowledge and righteous action. Inshallah ta'ala, tonight we're going to study together lesson 6, Zakat and its benefit. Zakat and its benefit. Al-Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he said zakat is one of the obligations of Islam. It is also one of its 5 pillars. And the most important amongst them, after the testimonies of faith and the prayer. Proof for its obligation can be found in the Book of Allah, the Sunnah of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the unanimous consensus of the Muslims. So whoever rejects its obligation is a disbeliever who has apostated from Islam. He should be made to repent and executed by the Islamic State if he fails to do so. And whoever whoever is cheap with giving it or minimizes any portion that is due from it, he is from the wrongdoers who are deserving of Allah's punishment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا يَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ يَبْخَلُونَ بِمَا آتَاهُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ هُوَ خَيْرًا لَهُمْ بَلْ هُوَ شَرٌ لَهُمْ سَيُطَوَّقُونَ مَا بَخِلُوا بِهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَلِلَّهِ مِيرَاتُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ. And let not those who hold back miserly from giving that which Allah has bestowed on them from His bounty think that it is good for them. Nay, it will be worse for them. The things that they held back from giving will be tied to their necks like a collar on the day of recompense. And to Allah belongs the heritage of the heavens and the earth. And Allah is well aware of that. Brother, if you can come closer here, inshallah, it's better. Barakallahu feek. And to Allah belongs the heritage of the heavens and the earth. And Allah is well aware of all that you do. Surah Ali Imran. And in Sahih al-Bukhari, Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu reported that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَنْ أَتَاهُ اللَّهُ مَالًا فَلَمْ يُؤَدِّ زَكَاتَهُ مُتِّلَ لَهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ شُجَاعًا أَقْرَعَ لَهُ زَبِيبَتَانِ يُطَوِّقُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ ثُمَّ يَأْخُذُ بِلَهْزَمَتَيْهِ يعني شِدْقَيْهِ يَقُولُ أَنَا مَالُكَ أَنَا كَنْزُكَ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, whoever Allah has given money to and does not give his zakat for it, it will take the form of a shiny-headed male serpent with 2 black spots over its eyes, which will encircle him on the day of the judgment and bite his cheeks, saying, I'm your money, I'm your wealth. So that shows you the danger of the one who does not give zakat. And subhanAllah, is not much. It's only 2.5% of your wealth. That's it. So every $100, you give $2.50. That's it. SubhanAllah. But some people, they're so greedy, wal-iyadu billah, they don't want to give. Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ يَكْنِزُونَ الدَّهَبَ وَالْفِضَّةَ وَلَا يُنْفِقُونَهَا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ فَبَشِّرْهُمْ بِعَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ يوم يحمى عليها في نار جهنم فتكوى بها جباههم وجنوبهم وظهورهم هذا ما كنزتم لأنفسكم فذوقوا ما كنتم تكنزون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah At-Tawbah, and those who hoard up gold and silver and do not spend on them in the way of Allah, i.e. giving zakat, give them the tidings of a painful punishment. This will be on the day when those treasures, i.e. gold and silver, will be heated in the fire of hell. May Allah save us from that. And with it, their foreheads, bodies, and backs will be branded. And it will be said to them, this is the treasure that you hoarded for yourselves. So taste what you used to hoard. أعوذ بالله من ذلك. أسأل الله safety. And in Sahih Muslim, Abu Hurairah رضي الله عنه reported that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, ما من صاحب ذهب ولا فضة لا يؤدي منها حقها إلا إذا كان يوم القيامة صفحت له صفائح من نار فأحمي عليها في نار جهنم فيقوى بها جنبه وجبينه وظهره كلما بردت أعيدت في يوم كان مقداره 50,000 سنة حتى يقضى بين العباد. Allah السلام والعافية. We ask Allah to protect all of us. There is no, the Prophet ﷺ said, there is no one that possesses gold and silver and does not give it his due, means zakat, on it, except that on the day of the judgment, it will be made into plates of fire, then dipped into the fire of hell, and with it his body, forehead, and back will be branded. Each time the plates grow cool, they will be reheated and brand him again. This will occur on the day of length of 50,000 years, because the day of judgment is 50,000 years. في يوم كان مقداره 50,000 سنة. So the day of judgment is one day, and it is what? 50,000 years. Imagine this person.
Our
years. نعم. Yes. Yes. 50,000 years of our years. So imagine this person, وعياذ بالله, he'll be punished over and over. Subhanallah. I mean, if this is the case of someone who is a Muslim, right? And he did not give the zakat, right? He will be punished like this. Until, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said this will occur on a day, the length of 50,000 years, until Allah judges his servant. Subhanallah. And then Allah will deal with him. Subhanallah. May Allah protect all of us. Zakat has many religious, behavioral, and communal benefits, of which we will mention the following from. From its religious benefit are, it is abiding by one of the pillars of Islam, upon which rest on an individual prosperity in this worldly life and the hereafter. So that's the first. The second, it brings a servant close to his Lord and increases his faith, his iman. This is the case with all of the acts of worship. Number three, what comes as a result of doing it, such a great reward. Allah says, يَمْحَقُ اللَّهُ الرِّبَى وَيُرْبِي الصَّدَقَاتِ. Allah will wipe away the reward of usury. Everybody understands what riba is, right? Anybody who doesn't understand riba here?
Interest.
Can anybody give me an example of interest?
If I wanted to sell.
No.
If I wanted to sell my gold watch.
Yes.
But however, I see something that fancies me, and it's more than my gold watch.
No.
So the person says, "I'll take your gold watch, and on top of that, you give me the remainder."
Thank you. All right, can anybody give us an example of riba?
This is like a car payment. You see something for $17,000, then after they finance and everything, it's $30,000.
Yes, absolutely. That is called riba.
And mortgage for it.
Yes, oh, in cars also. It's very common when they sell cars and houses also. Mm-hmm. It's all riba. Like, for example, the house costs $200,000, right? So he says, how much you have? He said, well, I have $100,000. He says, okay, you're going to put down $100,000, but because you don't have the other $100,000, we're going to have to charge you interest. So it's going to be like 5% or 2%, whatever the deal is. So whatever is above the remaining $100,000, that is called riba. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, فَمَنْ زَادَ أَوْ اسْتَزَادَ فَقَدْ أَرْبَى. whoever increases above that, then he has committed what? Riba.
Even credit card, right?
Yes, yes, absolutely, absolutely. So we have to be careful when it comes to riba, because riba is a very serious, serious sin, very serious sin. So here Allah says, the meaning of which, Allah will wipe away the reward of usury, riba, and increase that of charity, i.e. zakat. And he says, وَمَا أَتَيْتُم مِّن رِبَا لِيَرْبُوا فِي أَمْوَالِ النَّاسِ فَلَا يَرْبُوا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَمَا أَتَيْتُم مِّن زَكَاتٍ تُرِيدُونَ وَجَهَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُضْعِفُونَ. And this ayah also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and that which you give as a gift to others in order that it may increase your wealth by expecting something in return from other people's property has no increase with Allah. That is riba wal iyadu billah. For example, someone gives you a loan, right? He says, you know what? This is $100,000 loan. Within 2 years, give it to me with 150. That's riba. You see, that is riba. Iyadu billah. That is riba.
And those,
now, fadda.
And Allah, he also, like you mentioned the Quran.
Now.
The high magnitude, like, you know, of the riba.
Yes.
Because he said, like, dealing with riba or even getting involved with riba is like declaring war.
Yeah, declaring war. Allah said that in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah. فَإِنْ لَمْ تَأْدَنُوا فَإِنْ لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا فَأْدَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. If you don't stop dealing with riba, then prepare yourself, because Allah will wage a war against you. Allahu Akbar. So if Allah wage a war against someone, he will lose. He will lose. He will destroy everything. وَالْعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ. How many people, they say, well, I bought a house with riba and I thought I was going to reach happiness and all that, and it turned out I was living in misery. وَالْعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ. Yeah. اللَّهُ السَّلَامُ وَالْعَافِيَةِ. So here he says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the meaning of which, and that which you give as a gift to others in order that it may increase your wealth by expecting something in return from other people's property has no increase with Allah. But that which you give in zakat sincerely for the sake of Allah, it shows you also the importance of ikhlas, that you're doing it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those people shall have manifold increase. Allahu Akbar. So if you want your wealth to increase, you give sadaqah and you give zakat. You give zakat and you do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah will increase your wealth. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, من تصدق بعدل تمرة أي ما يعادل تمرة من كسب طيب من كسب طيب ولا يقبل الله إلا الطيبة فإن الله يأخذها بيمينه ثم يربيها لصاحبها كما يربي أحدكم فلوة فلوة حتى تكون مثل الجبل. Look at this hadith. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whoever gives away charity the size of a date, i.e. what is equivalent for a date, which is earned lawfully. So in other words, if it was not earned lawfully, Allah will not accept it. You see, that shows you the importance of what? Eating halal. Eating al-halal. And it's very important. And also from the benefit of eating al-halal, the dua is acceptable. And the best example is the story of the Sahabi, Sa'd bin Abi Waqqas, radiallahu anhu. And Sa'd bin Abi Waqqas, his mother was not a Muslim. And then he went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he asked him to make dua for her to accept Islam. And which he did, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she accepted Islam. Then Sa'd bin Abi Waqqas, radiallahu anhu, when he saw the effect of the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how his mother accepted Islam, he told him, O Messenger of Allah, can you make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make me from those that their da'wah is acceptable. Their dua is acceptable. So he gave him, subhanallah, he gave him a guideline. He said, Ya Sa'd, atib mat'amak, takun mustajab al-da'wah. He said, O Sa'd, earn halal. Earn halal. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept your dua. So if someone eats the haram, and then he makes dua, and then Allah does not accept the dua, they must know that they're doing something wrong. And the best example, you know, Sheikh Al-Uthaymeen rahimahullah, when he was talking about the halal, you know, livelihood versus the haram livelihood. And then he gave the example of the man in the hadith, the man who traveled extensively. This man, he travels all over doing business and all this, right? But this man, he imagine when you're traveling, one of the places that dua is accepted is when you're traveling. You know, when you're traveling, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts your dua. So the dua, al-musafir mustajab, the dua of the traveler is acceptable by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, when it's raining, for example, or the person who breaks the fast. When you break the fast, you make dua. Allah will accept your dua, right? So this person is traveling. And the Prophet ﷺ, he described this man. He said, "Ash'ata akbar, ash'ata akbar." So this man, he looks like he is like unkempt. He's not like well-groomed because he's traveling, you know. His clothing a bit wrinkly and all that. And then disheveled. His hair is not like really good and groomed and all that because he's traveling, right? There's nothing wrong with that. But the reason the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that, because when you are in that state, you are of state of humility. Huh? You are a state of humility. So you have that faqr. You have that you are, you need Allah. You are in desperate need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? So he's making dua. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned the barriers. He mentions the barriers. Al-hawajiz, the barriers. Okay? Al-mawani', the barriers. He said, وَمَطْعَمُهُ حَرَامٌ وَمَلْبَسُهُ حَرَامٌ وَغُدِيَ بِالْحَرَامِ فَأَنَّ يُسْتَجَبُ لِذَكَ. He said, his food is haram. Means the livelihood. Okay, now this man, his livelihood is haram. So he goes and he buys food for himself, for his family. It's all haram, wal-iyadu billah. Why? Because the livelihood is haram. So the food is haram. The clothing that he wears, wal-iyadu billah, is haram. And he is nourished with haram. He said, فَأَنَّا يُسْتَجَابُ لِذَكَ. How would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the dua of such a person? You see, it's very important for us to search for a halal job. Even if you don't make much, Allah will put barakah in your food. I remember, I mean, you can correct me if I'm wrong. Many of you, you're going to agree with me. Let's not talk about America. Let's talk about back home. The brothers who are from back home, whether Egypt, Morocco, Tunisia, Pakistan, India, wherever you may be, right? Back then, like if you were to go 100 years back, right? 100 years, 50 years, something like that. Subhanallah, the people, they used to earn little and halal. Wallahi, wallahi, wallahi. The whole family is fed. Everybody is happy. Subhanallah. But now look. They make a lot of money and there is no barakah in their wealth. There is no barakah in their wealth. And they complain. They complain because there is no barakah in their wealth. But back then, subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put barakah in that wealth. Why? Because it is halal. It is halal. And the Salaf, Ridwanullahi alayhim, from the Sahaba and the Tabi'een, they were very picky when it comes to eating al-halal. And they were very cautious to avoid al-haram. So much so that Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he used to have a servant. And this servant, he used to bring him food. So one time he brought him food and Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he ate that food. So he asked him, he said, where did you bring this food from? He said, كنت تكأهنت في الجاهلية. He said, before I became Muslim, at the time of the pre-ignorance time, I used to fool the mushrikeen, the polytheist. So I made myself like a fortune teller. You understand? So they will come to me and they will give me money and I will trick them. You know? Subhanallah. So Abu Bakr Siddiq, immediately when he heard that, he stuck his finger in his mouth and he began to vomit. He began to vomit. So he vomited all the food that he ate, the food that came from his servant because of what he told them. Look, subhanallah, look at al-wara. Subhanallah. And then he said, سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ he said, I heard the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم that any earning that comes from haram, the fire is more worthy of it. نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. You see. And this is Abu Bakr Siddiq رضي الله عنه. And there are many examples of the Salaf, how they used to be so cautious when it comes to the issue of al-haram. And in the biography of Imam Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man ibn Thabit al-Kufi rahimahullah, one of the greatest scholars, he's the first Imam from the four madahib, the four school of thought. Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, they said in his biography, because Abu Hanifa used to have so much wara', so much fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he was very cautious when it comes to these issues of al-halal wal-haram. So he abstained from eating meat, lamb, for 5 years. He did not eat lamb because what happened, the village where Abu Hanifa rahimahullah ta'ala lived, an ewe was stolen, the female sheep, ewe. So was stolen. And he asked the people, he said, what is the lifespan of an ewe? They said 5 years. So he did not, he abstained from eating the lamb for 5 years for fear that he will eat some of that haram meat. Because the person is going to steal it. He's going to sell it. He's going to sell it. And then it's going to be consumed, you see. But subhanAllah, these are levels. They are very high levels. This is an imam. This is a great imam of the sunnah. Look, subhanAllah, their wara'. Al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, one time a man invited the people. It was, he circumcised his son, so he invited the people for to a walima, banquet. So the man, he served the food in silver utensils. In silver utensils. So Imam Ahmad, he got up and he walked out of the place. He walked out. So all the people, they followed Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah. Why? Because the food was served in silver utensils. And one time, Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, you know, rahan, when you pawn something with someone, like for example, you want something from someone, and he says, you know what, I want a guarantee from you. You said, naam. So you say, you know what, I'm going to leave this watch with you. If I don't bring you back your property, you can have my watch. This is called rahm. Rahm. So Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, what he did, he pawned his bucket, satl, with a man. So when he came back to get it, to retrieve it, the man, he wanted to test al-wara' of Imam Ahmad. He wanted to test the piety and the cautiousness of Imam Ahmad. So he mixed up two buckets. Look. So he said, which one is yours, Ya Aba Abdullah? He said, I don't know. They look alike. He said, Imam, Ya Imam, this is yours. I was just testing you. He said, Anta minhu fi hil. Subhanallah. Imam Ahmad, he said, it's halal for you. Take it. And he walked away from him. Subhanallah. He didn't even take it. The man, he knows this is the bucket of Imam Ahmad. He said, you know what? Anta minhu fi hil. It is halal for you. I give it to you. You can have it. Subhanallah. Why? Because these imams and the salaf, they were very cautious. And subhanAllah, the fruits and the benefits of eating al-halal and being cautious, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would accept the dua. In the biography of Imam Al-Zahid Al-Qudwa, Imam Abdullah ibn Mubarak, rahimahullah, and I advise all of you, brothers and sisters, to read the biography of this imam, Abdullah ibn Mubarak. This imam is amazing. Rahimahullah ta'ala. Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak. A man passed by him, a blind man. He said, Ya Imam, Make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala restore my sight back. He said, Allahumma rudda alayhi basara. He said, Wallah, restore his sight back to him. Immediately the man starts seeing, subhanallah. And how many of us, we make dua? And our dua does not go anywhere. Why? Because there are barriers, barakallahu feekum. And this is a very important issue that I felt like expanding on it and, explaining more on it. So he said, whoever gives away charity the size of a date, subhanallah, and what is equivalent to a date. So it's not about the number. It's about ikhlas. When you give something like a little bit, subhanallah, Allah accepts, subhanallah. But when someone gives too much, but he's showing off, and he wants the people to say good things about him and the like, he's not going to go anywhere. Because you destroyed your ibadah with riya, showing off. And you want sum'ah, reputation and the like. In order that, he said, whoever gives away charity the size of a date, i.e. to what is equivalent to a date which is earned lawfully. Since Allah only accepts the good, lawful things, Allah will indeed take it with His right hand and cause it to grow for its owner. Just as one of you raises up his colt to the point that the charity will become like the size of a mountain. Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah. Look, subhanallah, al-ikhlas. And also when you do something, fi sabilillah, and you earn it lawfully. You earn it lawfully. This is reported by al-Bukhari and Muslim. And also, the Shaykh, he said, number four benefit, Allah wipes away the minor sins by way of it. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَالصَّدَقَةُ تُطْفِئُ الْخَطِيعَةُ كَمَا يُطْفِئُ الْمَاءُ النَّارِ. He said, giving charity wipes away sins just as water extinguishes fire. The Shaykh, he said, the word charity, sadaqah, here refers to the zakat, as well as the supurgatory form of charity. So sadaqah, this word sadaqah, means two things. It can mean zakat itself, which is an obligation. It can also mean that which is supurgatory. You know, sadaqah that you give to al-miskeen, al-faqir, and other than that. From the benefit, it has, and a person's character are, this is on the person's character. First, it causes him to follow the way of the generous individuals, possessing kindness. And two, giving zakat requires a person to characterize himself with the attribute of mercy and sympathy towards his destitute brothers. And Allah shows mercy to those who have mercy on others. As the Prophet ﷺ said, "Irhamu man fil ard, yirhamkum man fil sama." Have mercy upon those who are upon the earth. The one who is above the heaven will have mercy upon you. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Shaykh, he said, number three, what has been witnessed is that giving financial and physical support to Muslims causes the heart to become open and the souls to become pleased. And it causes a person to become loved and respected according to the extent of support he gives to his fellow brothers. Subhanallah, yes, very true. When there is someone who is very generous, very loving, and he takes care of his brothers and sisters, those who are destitute, you know, he takes care of them, everybody loves that person. Everybody will make dua for him all the time. Subhanallah. The Shaykh, he said, number four, giving zakat cleans one's character from stinginess and miserliness. As Allah says, خُدْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُطَحِّرُهُمْ وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا. Take the charity, means zakat, from their wealth in order to purify and cleanse them by way of it. The Shaykh, he said, from its communal benefit, zakat provides for the needs of the poor, who are the majority of the people in most countries. Number two, zakat strengthens the Muslims and raises their status. This is why one of the areas where zakat can be given in is jihad in the cause of Allah, as we will mention later by the will of Allah. Number three, it removes the grudges and ill feelings found in the hearts of the poor and the destitute. This is since when the poor sees the money, the wealth he have, and they're not benefiting them with, by giving them neither a little nor a lot, it is likely that they will hold hatred and rancor for the wealthy, as they did not enforce their rights or provide for their needs. Right or wrong? Yes. But when the wealthy do give some of their money to them, at the end of every year, i.e. after holding the wealth for 1 year time, these things terminate and there comes about love and harmony. It's very true. The Sheikh said, number four, giving zakat boosts one's wealth and increases its blessedness. As it's stated in the hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which he said, مَا نَقَصَتْ صَدَقَةٌ مِنْ مَالٍ. Charity does not detract from one's wealth. Subhanallah. So when you give zakat from your wealth, actually you're increasing your wealth. It's not decreasing. This means that even though charity, zakat, takes away from one's wealth, numerically, it indeed never takes away from its blessedness on its increasing in the future. Rather, Allah will replace what you gave away and bless your wealth. Number five, zakat is a means for spreading and distributing wealth throughout the community. This is since if some wealth is given out, its range is broadened and many people benefit from it, contrary to when the wealth is just preserved amongst the rich, since the poor will not gain any part of it. Allahu Akbar. Look how beautiful this religion is. So the society will benefit the poor, the needy, the widows, and all those people. Subhanallah, they will benefit from that zakat. Zakat is required. The Sheikh says all of these benefits that come from giving zakat show clearly that zakat is something necessary and required in order to rectify the individual and the society. How perfect is Allah, the all-knowing, the most wise. Zakat is required to be given on specific form of wealth. And inshallah, that's going to be the next class, inshallah, tomorrow after Fajr. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all al-ilm al-nafi' wal-amal al-salih. الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله وسلم على محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم.
How do you determine the date for
giving the zakat?
Yeah.
Very important.
The due date.
Yes. In order for the zakat to be due, on your wealth, there are two conditions that have to be met. The first one, the ulama, they mention that the Islamic year has to elapse. For example, you started saving money in the month of Sha'ban, which is this month, month of Sha'ban or Ramadan, right? So next Sha'ban, right, or Ramadan, then if your money meets a nisab, which is about 85 gram of gold. So the value of that, let's say it is $3,500, for example. So if you have $3,500 and up, you have to give zakat. You understand? So we're just giving you an example. So if the nisab, the threshold is $3,500, then if you have $3,500 and up, then you give 2.5% of your wealth.
On saving. But,
yes.
Saving.
On saving.
Money.
Not something that you use.
You're going to use.
No, if you use this, the things that you use, you don't give no zakat on it. But only the money that you have saved from this Sha'ban to the next Sha'ban of the next year, or Ramadan to the next Ramadan. But it has to be the Islamic calendar. Some people go by the Gregorian calendar. It doesn't work like that. Right? From December to December. No, it doesn't going to work like that. It has to be Islamic calendar. Islamic calendar. From month, Sha'ban or Ramadan, or any of the Islamic month, to the next month of the next year of the same month of this year. Whatever you have saved, you look at your saving. If it meets the Nisab, then you give the zakat. Now. Yes.
Are kids allowed to do that when they have like a lot of money they save, like a lot?
Yes. The scholars have mentioned actually that when it comes to zakat al-mal, the zakat on your wealth, even the child has to give the zakat. Not the child who... No, the child... If the child does not discern, like he doesn't have that tamiz, discern, then his father, his guardian, is supposed to give zakat on his behalf. Like, for example, if you have money, your dad, your mom gave you money, right? So you had this money saved up from Ramadan to next Ramadan, right? So that wealth that you have, if it meets the nisab, right, which is the amount... like of 85 grams of gold, whatever comes out of that, the equal of that, then you give zakat. Even al-mashnoon, the insane person, the ulama, they mention that the guardian has to give zakat on his behalf. So the child is not immune from that. Yes.
No. So,
yeah.
Because I save money not like from Ramadan to another, I save like five Ramadan.
Five Ramadan? How do you do that?
From Atlanta, I collected all my money. So.
But do you save it or do you use it?
Save it.
MashaAllah, that's good.
I didn't even use one quarter yet.
But you have to give zakat. If you have not given zakat for five Ramadan, you have to give zakat.
Yes.
Now you know what to do, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Family, such as parents, if they need it. Could that count as
a
zakat or not? That's
something
obligatory.
No, zakat is only for those 8 categories that Allah mentioned in the Quran.
Yes.
If the parents are poor, you can give them zakat. If they're poor. But if they're not poor, you don't give them zakat.
No. Okay. No, I'm saying if they're in need.
If they are?
If they're in need.
In need, yes.
So does that count?
Yes, absolutely. Because zakat, Allah mentioned for al-fuqara wal-masakeen. Al-fuqara, those who are poor. Masakeen, those who have, but they don't have enough. And sometimes parents can be like that. You know, they have, but they don't have enough. So you can give them the zakat. Yes, those who are close to you, they are more worthy of... Yeah, absolutely. The parents, the brothers, the sisters... You know, those who are close to you, they are more worthy of it. Yeah.
So when you say with the zakat, right? So like, say for instance, you have like a 401k.
Yes.
Right? So do you pay zakat?
For 401k, you don't have it in your possession yet, right?
Well, it's
sinner. It's there, but you don't have it. You don't have access to it, do you?
If you can call them, you can take
it. No. Usually, 401k, you don't have access.
401k, when you leave the job.
Yes.
Okay, you get separate from your job.
Yes.
You can get a loan.
Yes.
They give you 50% loan or something like that. And you don't want to do that
because it's going to accrue interest.
Interest.
Yes, yes. So, in case of 401k, because you don't have the money in your possession, there is no zakat on it until you have it in your possession.
You have access
to it. Yeah, you have access to it.
You have access to it.
Right,
I got another question.
Sure.
Say for like,
you're supposed to have only one question, but yeah, go ahead.
Say for like you got somebody, they're not Muslim, right?
Yes.
And they're dealing with interest. And then they accept Islam.
Yes.
Do they give back that possession or whatever do they have?
It's theirs and it's halal for them. The scholars have mentioned this. So all that money is for the, is their money. It's halal.
No, no. What I'm saying, like, no. Say for instance, like they're making a house payment or a car payment.
Yes.
And then they accept Islam.
And they're still making that payment.
Do they still make those payments, or they get that car back? And
Once they become Muslim, then riba is haram for them. They should not be dealing with riba and the like. So in that case, they do the best to get rid of it. Now, but if they had earned, like for example, money through interest and stuff, that money is halal for them once they accept Islam. Yes.
So to his example, if let's say you have been paying for a house for 20 years and
yes.
you have 10 years left.
Right.
And you were not Muslim at that time.
Yes.
When you became Muslim, so you tried to get rid of the house.
Yeah, because you have interest, so you should try your best to get rid of that. Because now, the ruling applies, because he's Muslim now. Yeah, now.
Yeah.
But what happened if you have the intention, so let's just say for month of Shaban, you put in $200, but the next month, something comes about.
You have to use it.
You have to use it.
Yeah. There's no zakat on it. The zakat is only on what is saved from 1 year, from one this month to the month of the next year, like Sha'ban to Sha'ban or Ramadan to Ramadan.
Well, in that case, let's just say you know for sure that you're not financially stable in that nature.
Yes.
Like you cannot save any amount of money.
You can't save. There is no zakat. The zakat is only what is saved after 1 year elapse. And it meets the nisab. Na'am, fadla.
Are you allowed to like give anything like nice, like a car, what you don't like, and it's still nice? Or like a car that you saved for the other Ramadan, like car too?
I didn't get your question.
Instead of money, just say you have
what?
A car.
Na'am, fadla. Let him ask a question.
Let's say I put up some money for zakat. I save some money. I end up spending that money. The year goes by.
Yes.
I end up putting some more money, but it wasn't the original money that I saved for zakat. Do I still pay the zakat?
At the end of the year, did you still have money saved up?
Yeah, but it wasn't the original money that I saved up.
But you still had money saved up, right?
Yeah.
You give zakat on it. You give zakat on it. Yeah.
Can I try the help?
No, don't touch.
No, like try the voice.
Let's just say you don't have a saving, but you come across money randomly that meets your Islam. Can you just give it from there for that time or no?
I didn't understand.
So for instance, let's just say,
I didn't mean to cut you off, but I'm guessing what he's saying is basically like, in the U.S., everybody get a tax return, right?
Yes.
So, like he's saying, you couldn't save money. So, at the end of the year, around December, February, or whatever, everybody get a lump sum of money.
Okay.
You pay zakat on that money.
It has to, 1 year has to elapse. You understand? It has to be 1 year.
So, if you get that money, like in February...
Yes.
The following year, so you have to hold that money until the following year, and then you pay the
tax. Yes, like you look at the Islamic month. Okay, like so let's say that February coincides with the month of Rajab, for example. Then from Rajab to the next Rajab of the next year.
Islamic
if that money was used, there is no zakat. There is no zakat. If the money was saved,
yeah.
Then you give the zakat.
About
No, I'm just guessing. I mean, no, the nisab is 85 grams of gold.
Okay, so
that's the nisab.
85 grams of gold.
Yes.
Now, let's just say I have not been able to make any form of 85 grams of gold.
Yes.
I've been struggling financially throughout the year. But all of a sudden, I come to a big payout in which I have 85
grams. Yes.
I can make the payment right then and there for the zakat, or no?
No.
No.
It has to be 1 year.
1 year.
Okay. Yes. Exactly.
But what if, same as like, nobody don't,
yep.
Like you said, you got a financial problem, right? And some kind of way, well, I guess you said it has to be a whole year. Like
yeah.
You said, it has to be a whole year.
A whole year.
If you're not saving money. Then
right.
But what if, you know, if it doesn't, if it's not a whole year and you just want to give zakat anyways?
Yeah, you can give zakat anyway, and Allah will reward you for that. There's no problem, inshallah.
Okay.
Yeah, alhamdulillah.
Now can I ask my question?
Yes.
So are you allowed to like give other stuff you save from the other Ramadan to the next Ramadan, like a toy what you don't like and it still works?
That's considered sadaqah. That's not zakat. That is sadaqah. Like for example, there's some toys that you use, like cars and stuff like that, that you used and you're not using anymore, and you want to give it to another kid. That is sadaqah, charity, which is good.
What if you got a car but you never even wanted to play with it?
And you want to give it as a gift?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah.
If you look at, like you said, like 2.5%, right?
Yes.
If it's 4,000, it's like insane, like that stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
You're talking like, $100.
Yeah.
Which people, spend just like to pay their taxes, which they're going to pay Mr. Sam. They pay sometimes like 150 to 200 just like, the tax accountant. Who's going to do your business? That's besides whatever can check in your mind, right? So if we think about it, it's not like a big deal. I mean, anyway.
No, it's not much.
Yeah.
Zakat is not much.
You get my point?
I just give like $200.
Yeah, it's just like, okay,
Okay, so if I'm unable to pay zakat, but I can give sadaqah when I get the chance to.
Yeah.
But it still wouldn't equivalize. It would not equivalize.
Yes.
You have to have a way of giving us actual zakat.
Right. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all beneficial knowledge and righteous action. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim.